Now we turn to a story you'll see here only on News Nation. A 50-mile pipeline set to run through the city of Memphis could create major issues for residents, and that's why community activists are now speaking up big time. They've even gotten the attention of former Vice President Al Gore. News Nation correspondent Michael Shore joining us live in Memphis tonight with the very latest.
Rob, good evening to you from Memphis. Good evening to you, Marty. We are here because of this story. It's an unusual story for Memphis, but not necessarily when you know the history of pipelines in this country. But what has happened here has changed a lot, even in the last week, with many national figures getting involved in opposing the pipeline and also dividing some in the black community here, some of whom think that maybe it's okay to take the money that's being paid to get this pipeline here. We thought we would come to Memphis to take a closer look. A proposed crude oil pipeline that would pass through Memphis, Tennessee, may be scheduled to be built underground. But thanks to community activists here, the issue is no longer under the radar.
Dr. King, when he was convincing folks to come to Memphis, he said this: the movement lives or dies in Memphis.
At issue is the Byhalia Connection Pipeline, which would bring crude oil from a Memphis refinery to Mississippi.
What we want is to stop the pipeline. And what we realize is we really want to stop the environmental injustice and environmental racism happening in our city and in many other parts of our country.
Justin J. Pearson is co-founder of Memphis Community Against the Pipeline, or MCAP, and was the principal organizer of a Sunday rally that brought former Vice President and Nobel laureate Al Gore to town.
We are engaged in a struggle that we must win.
A fiery Gore laid out that struggle for rally-goers in a speech lasting over 20 minutes.
This pipeline project is a reckless, racist ripoff. Reckless, racist ripoff. Remember the three R's.
The pipeline would require the use of eminent domain through South Memphis, an area that is nearly 80% African American. In early February, Wyatt Price, supervising land agent for Plains All American, said of going through this part of Memphis that, quote, we took basically a point of least resistance.
This resistance ain't nothing compared to what they're going to see if they try to keep going with this.
This has gone on for years, and people have picked black neighborhoods for what the white neighborhoods, more fluent neighborhoods, didn't want in theirs. NIMBY, not in my backyard.
Steve Cohen's always working for this district, and thank you, Steve, for being here.
Highway construction has gone through black neighborhoods. Industrial sites have gone into black neighborhoods.
In a letter to Memphis residents, Byhalia said, quote, this route was chosen after carefully reviewing population density, environmental features, local gathering spots, and historic cultural sites. The companies have used eminent domain laws and offered payments to Memphians whose homes fall in the path of the pipeline. They're also suing residents who are not obliging.
For the last 8 or 10 months, I've been had guys coming by, want me to sign papers, food.
This property has been in Clyde Robinson's family for generations. The son of sharecroppers remembers working the fields as a child.
I had to break the land with a mule, one mule, 7, 8 years old. I turned around in the field so many times, they named me Turnaround.
Now a former vice president, a member of Congress, and several news cameras were standing with Robinson and his family on his land as he tries to keep it.
Mr. Robinson and Miss Odom and Mrs. Robinson and Miss Fitzgerald they're just strong people, and they're so proud of their land and how long they've had it.
Memphis lawyer Scott Crosby began representing those being sued by the Byhalia Connection Pipeline after receiving a call from another lawyer.
He also said, and we can't pay you. So I think that's a friend call.
The volunteerism in the volunteer state has been pervasive on this issue.
Everybody can be an activist. It is the choice to be proximate to the suffering of other people.
The activism has also crossed the state line to Mississippi.
So it's going to cut across in between two homes within our neighborhood, about the length of a football field.
In rural Olive Branch, Mississippi, Chris Pilcher describes the path the pipeline may take in his neighborhood as he told us how he learned of the project.
So in 2019, I was informed that there was a meeting with majority landowners out here.
Pilcher bought his land in 2015 and completed his home in 2019. He does not want this to go forward.
It has to go from Valero, right, across the state line. So if they beat it over there, then I think we're good.
For Justin Pearson, part of beating it on the Memphis side involves dealing with those in his community who have accepted payoffs.
No one in this community could be upset that a person who is lower income, making $26,000 a year, sees an opportunity to get $500 and takes it.
We did receive a written response from Byhalia on claims of racism.
Water has always been important to Memphis, called the Bluff City because of its position here on a bend in the Mississippi River. But Memphis is also the largest U.S. city to get all of its drinking water from an aquifer. And that's what has residents here concerned.
We are standing in front of a water well, which pumps water from the Memphis Sand Aquifer.
Ward Archer started Protect Our Aquifer, not just over the pipeline, but because of other threats to the Memphis water supply.
Right now, we are standing about 50 yards from where the pipeline is going to cut through this neighborhood.
Archer is frustrated by the lack of community knowledge about the project. Even as we spoke with him, Ruth Geeter of South Memphis came over to us and hadn't even heard of the pipeline project that would be yards from her home. He cites frustration with Army Corps of Engineers Permit 12.
There's a clause in there that says, you know, you can't have a pipeline anywhere near public source water input or something. But we took that to mean no pipeline. And they came back and said, no, that's surface water only. We don't know about the aquifer.
I asked the former vice president if the federal government can do anything about this project.
The national government could direct the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers to retract the permit under which this pipeline was granted permission to go across this territory. They didn't look at the safety of the underground aquifer, and they should take that into account.
I wondered if there could be a partial victory in this fight.
But there is no partial victory. There is no Byhalia pipeline by Valero and Plains All American. And there is a victory in our city, in our community, saying we need to do a better job at caring for this place.
Michael Schur, News Nation, Memphis, Tennessee.
As you can tell, there is clearly a lot of community activity around this. There are hearings later this week. We reached out to Byhalia Connection Pipeline. They wouldn't come on camera with us, but they did give us a written statement. I asked them, Rob and Marnie, whether or not Al Gore was right. I asked them whether when the person who said that they were going to take the path of least resistance or the point of least resistance, which really angered some people in the community here, what they thought about that. And their spokesperson, Katie Martin, said to me, the comment from our contractor was taken out of context in articles and does not represent our company's views, nor does it reflect the extensive routing process we undertook in South Memphis to find a route with the fewest collective impacts on the community. This is a story that's at its genesis right now. I'm happy News Nation is here to cover it, and we will certainly follow it till its end. Rob, Marnie.
And Michael, before we let you go, it really is eye-opening, so we're glad you're there sharing that story with us and with our audience. Can you give us a sense of a timeline when some big decisions, key decisions need to be made before this thing either gets moved forward or not?
It's a great question, Marty. So there's going to be a hearing at the city council level here in Memphis. There's still some city council members who think that maybe this isn't the worst idea because some people are getting some money and it will provide jobs in Memphis. On the other side, they're saying it's temporary. That's going to happen on Tuesday. There's a preliminary court hearing on Friday. Scott Crosby, the lawyer who we heard from and talked to there, is saying that's a first step. But the law, the court appearances are going to go on in April as well. They do have appeals. What they first have to find out is whether or not this rises to the level of eminent domain. If they can prove that this is not for public use, has no public benefit, then they say the case will be closed. However, I would imagine the Byhalia Connection pipeline will appeal, and we will follow all of those developments, Marty.